You're listening to Getting Things Done, the official podcast of the David Allen Company, with our feature conversation between David Allen, Mark Wallace, and Mike Williams talking about getting things done for teens. Welcome everyone to Getting Things Done, GTD for shorthand. My name's Andrew J. Mason, and this podcast is all about helping you on your journey practicing the art of stress-free productivity. Today, David, Mark, and Mike will be discussing the brand new Getting Things Done for Teens book. What's different? What's the same? And some of the wisdom they've garnered in writing the book together. And now, without further ado, here's David Allen, Mark Wallace, and Mike Williams talking about GTD for Teens.
Hi guys, David Allen here. I'm here with Mike Williams and Mark Wallace, the two heavy lifters of the new book, Getting Things Done for Teens. And so we wanted to use this informal conversation about why the book, what about the book, etc. So I'm going to sort of lead this thing, and delighted to have any of you listening into this. Let's start out with why Getting Things Done for Teens.
I'll take a stab at starting, and Mark, I'll hand the ball over to you. Well, first of all, there's a deep debt of gratitude for you, David, for creating the space, the conditions, this thing we call Getting Things Done. And as a result of that, there's been a generation or two of people in it. And Mark and I got caught up in that web. And then also as it started rolling out to the world, and we saw this at the David Allen Company, people were saying, hey, I wish I would have discovered this earlier, and how can we bring this to our kids? And I was certainly one of those people before I even joined the David Allen Company. And what we found naturally was people were experimenting with GTD, using the principles, and they were working. And so really the book just is an excuse to lay something out as a template that people can pick up, people being caring adults and young people can pick up. They can play with it. They can test and try things. We got things in the book at the back end called a lab. So it's meant to be an invitation to come in and play with principles, test them, try them, see what works for you. And I think that will continue to help people discover things going forward. It'll help the teens hopefully find their intrinsic motivation and apply it to the world faster than we did. I have no idea what's going to show up, but from my perspective, there's a heck of a lot of stress out there right now and a heck of a lot of creativity that needs to be released. So I'm hoping the book can serve in a role in helping get that out and into the world from this younger generation. So, Mark, I'll kick it over to you.
Yeah, I think a very similar process for me. This was back in 2007 when I first picked up GTD and started implementing myself. I had the moment that a lot of the caring adults are having is, why didn't I have this going through high school or college? And the difficulty that I had, the struggles that I went through until I, started figuring things out. And I teach in the public school system. And so immediately my heart went to, well, this can't be just about me. I'm working with these kids and I have an opportunity here to share these principles that I'm learning and applying. And so it just kind of created a natural lab for me to start experimenting with language and with processes and activities and things with kids. And I was so excited by what I was discovering and what was unearthing, and the students that I was working with, even as young as some as first graders, 7 years old, who were starting to pick up some of these principles and some of this language, that I thought there is something here that can be learned proactively versus reactively. I think a lot of the adults who approach GTD are coming from a reactive standpoint, saying, oh, I'm overwhelmed, I'm overloaded, and finally finding something that can reverse some of that momentum. And what an opportunity we have to be proactive in the teaching of this. And before habits are formed, learning some of these principles, just as seeds to grow later. So the fact that we could take that and put it into a form like the book it's been a wild ride. It's been a joy, and anxious to see if there's one young person out there who finds as much benefit as we have, it'll all be worth it.
Mark, thank you so much. And both you guys, I have to say, as you were writing, and Mike and Mark did the heavy lifting of really writing most of the text of this. You know, I sort of just put my eyes on it, and it's the methodology that I developed over these years. But as I was reading this, and I went, pack and unpack. You know, Mark, the seven-year-olds, they still have packs. They still have to unpack and repack, right?
So exactly.
At whatever age, somebody has to unpack and repack anything based upon how they're engaging with the world. I have to do that. I just was out yesterday, and I had my pack, and I had stuff in it. And so I've trained myself to make sure when I come back, whether a briefcase or a pack or whatever I've got, unload it right then. Stick anything that's back into my in tray that needs to be done. So it's fascinating to see how you guys have sort of identified the behaviors that can be translated to behaviors that, you know, kids at these early ages actually need and couldn't, shouldn't. You're not born doing this, right?
Yeah. Well, what you're referring to is the backpack, unpack, and repack. But when you think about these kids at school, they're the ultimate road warriors. They get up from their home. They traverse their day from one meeting, AE classroom, to another, to another, to another. Then they might have a post-school activity, and then they have to come back home. And just following that round trip can be totally fascinating for that student and for the family dynamic. So for example, in the back of the book, we have this section called the labs. And one of the things in the labs is kind of before I leave the house checklist. And I don't know about you, but Mark and I have talked about this where you have a child who leaves the house. They got some kind of field trip or they need something. They need a permission slip. You're sitting right there on the counter. And then they walk right out the door without it. They get to school. And they're missing this important piece of thing and they can't get on the bus or whatever. So call the parent at work. Now you've got to leave work, maybe have lost wages, go and help the kid out and that kind of stuff. So one of the easy things, in addition to the backpack, unpack, and repack, is the notion of checklists that can help kids throughout the day. But it's all kinds of fun stuff. And then we think we're in this paperless world. But these backpacks are loaded with forms you got to sign. You know, they got to make their way back to the parents and then back to the teachers. Dirty socks from gym, you know, all kinds of old sandwiches. So, Mark, you've got oodles of backpacks coming in and out of your classroom every day. What else do you see in that kind of neighborhood?
Oh, I'm not even sure we want to get into all the things we see coming in backpacks. But I think the beauty of it is the function of all the things that we're talking about. The function of the GTD principles don't change. It's just the form that's changing. And so we just thought a lot about how do we contextualize that form and make it accessible and appropriate for wherever a teen finds themselves, that the principle still holds. It's just finding the right form that works and getting those easy wins, like the backpack, unpack, repack, and the checklist, and just simple things that hold true to that function and just always change form as the complexity of the life changes with it.
Well, let's talk about complexity, because as you guys know, adults, sophisticated, savvy, classy, highly professional people pick up my book and are overwhelmed. I mean, there's just too much in there. It's like an encyclopedia of how do I sort of manage my life? And obviously, being able to create some sort of a more simplified version of that for somebody who's not ready for that kind of complexity. But getting things done for teen actually includes a lot of all of that complexity in there. So talk to me about that. What were your thoughts as you were deciding how to frame the getting things done methodology for potentially, obviously, a savvy and intelligent teenager? But what went on in your mind about how do we simplify this, or how do we codify this, or how do we language it?
You know, one of the things that comes to mind in this question about complexity, particularly in the teenage years, you get your normal teenageness complexity, just all the normal stuff that goes on when all of us were teenagers. Now there's a piece of that that gets amplified due to technology. So you've got
I'm unlike you, Mike.
Yeah, now my feelings are really hurt. What the heck happened? All right. And then the other kind of thing, as we were writing this book, the area of focus section really speaks to me, because as an adult working with a child through their development years, you hold some areas of focus, and then over time you give them to the child. Like in the early days, you feed them. Then you kind of help them do their homework. But later on, they have to manage their own homework process. You know, they go out and get a job. They have after-school activities. They move from middle school to high school. So as they move through these seasons in life, their complexity increases. So for me, the book is really like a packet of seeds. Some of the principles you can apply early and they'll take hold. And some of them will require the higher levels of complexity that some kids haven't hit yet. So it's always a persistent evergreen invitation to come back in. Like you said, the original GTD is full on everything. And GTD for teens, I think it'll be a great service to teens as they move through life. And I think it'll actually sneak up on adults and be a good reminder about these other things as well. And then I think in the introduction, the other thing that we do is we give a nice introduction for parents to remember what it was like to be a first timer. You know, what was the first time you made a phone call to an adult? Your heart was beating fast. You didn't know what was going to happen. So our teens are going through many first time experiences. So from an adult perspective, go back to that beginner's mind. And then from a teen perspective, just knowing that taking a next action, that the world will respond and you'll start the learning journey. So for me, that kind of encapsulates the complexity part that I've seen.
Yeah, I think in terms of complexity as it relates to the methodology, one of the things that we gave some thought to was just how do we think about learning styles of teens and add some layers of accessibility to the book. And so one of the ways we did that was just making it highly visual. You know, the book is upwards of 300 pages, but about half of that is illustrations. And, you know, they say a picture's worth 1,000 words. That may or may not be true, but it can replace 1,000 words. And to be able to look at an image and maybe relate to that content in a different way, maybe taps into another learning style, those that are more visual, like I am. And then making it interactive and having some just quick trials that try this and just see what you feel, see what you experience afterwards. I think sometimes when adults approach the GTD methodology, they want to go all in. They want to do everything at once. And really what we tried to do is break it down into, hey, just try this activity and see what shows up. And if that one, whatever shows up from there, try the next one and continue to experiment and play and just see which part of it you're connecting with and build from there and just try to make each individual component as accessible as we can.
Very cool. Early returns, guys. You know, the book's been out like now for, you know, a couple of weeks, you know, and, you know, galleys of this have been out in a few people's hands. Some of the early returns I've gotten were parents and adults and went, I read this and I went, this reminded me of stuff I should be doing. You know, so early returns from your populations and intersections and networks.
Yeah, I think the early returns, probably the most commentary I've received on it is just on the visual aspect of being able to look at the thinking processes and the methodology versus read about it, that's just been a different, maybe a little bit of a different take or a different, my wife was a good example of that. She mentioned, oh, that I've heard you talk about this and I've read the book. This is now, I'm seeing this in a different way. She's an artist. She's very visual. And so that was something that she particularly latched onto. And then that seems to be a consistent thread with kids and teens and tweens and those that have had access to the book early on. No, Mike, what about you?
I have to insert, let me say, I mean, Miggy and Cortland, the fact that you gave a visual to the amygdala, the survival brain and the forebrain as two very different dynamics and how teens have those things that they're trying to grapple with or have to start to learn to deal with, was just brilliant. You know, and I think that's so true. I mean, it's true for all of us, but particularly how much am I willing to be into my survival distracted, you know, brain by doing all the distractions I need to? How much do I need to produce more positively focused energy in what I should be doing or what I'm telling myself would be more valuable for me to do? That was brilliant, actually, to produce the graphics for that kind of thing, for sure.
I had just a quick story on that. I had an experience with a student who's, I think he was 12 at the time, and quiet classroom. We talk a lot about the parts of the brain and Miggy and Cortland, and quiet classroom, kids are working, doing their thing. And I hear a shout out of the back of the room and it slams his hand down and yells, Miggy. And we kind of paused and went, wait, but he said, sorry, I got distracted. And he was recognizing that part of himself that was moving too quickly and kind of impulsive. And so we just kind of got a laugh out of that. And
that's great.
Yeah. Great stuff.
Yeah. No, I mean, the Miggy, Cortland, the maps, the charts, the visuals, they're meant to kind of show GTD as a game and, I think we did a pretty good job of letting the beauty of the methodology speak to itself, because GTD is just, for me, it's a series of well-placed questions. It doesn't tell you what to do. It helps you find an answer within you, whatever that is. So Miggy and Cortland are part of the mix. They're two pieces of your brain that are very, very important. When you learn how to harness the superpowers of each of them, it can be quite magical. And when you can name them, you know, Maggie Weiss was a big mentor of mine. She taught me the value of naming something so you can then understand and then slam the desk and say, Miggy, you're like overrunning my brain. And if you recognize that, you're like, okay, I need to call on Cortland power now to kind of slow down. What's on my mind? How do I get back into a ready state, which is another thing that we talk about in the book.
So who's going to buy this book? I mean, again, this was the big question we kind of all had, because this was sort of produced for two audiences, caring adults as well as the kids themselves, you know, who might need or want to do this. So have either of you had any experience yet with a caring adult who read it and then handed it to their kid and the red kid read it, or any early returns yet on who's picking this up and what are they getting out of it?
Yeah, I mean, on my end, I see a lot of adults really excited to read it. And then they give me a wink and it's like, it's for my kids, wink, wink. And it's kind of for them to get back into it, but hopefully to hand it off to their kids. And for me, and I think for Mark too, one of our visions of wild success is that this book ends up on the summer reading list, the must reading list for all schools across the world, so kids can get access to it. But the early returns on my end are the adults are buying it and handing it off, and then it's coming back with sticky notes and all kinds of stuff if the adults say, hey, what in this has your attention? Something grabs the kid's attention. It could be the Yoda quote that we had in there, or it could be something in the lab. Some people come back and they're attracted to the idea of a next action. Like, oh, okay, I get that. So those kinds of returns I'm getting. How about you, Mark?
Yeah, I think so too. And I had a couple of teens that were just saying that when they were reading about the amount of inputs, whether it's from school or from social media or from, and that speed, the speed at which that is happening, that really resonated. That I was like, yep, that's me. That's all night, every night. And I think one of the things, when you talk about who's buying it, I think one of the things we're hoping for is that it can be a shared experience, that it's not an individual reader, that even, you know, another vision of wild success is just a common vocabulary amongst a family, amongst a teacher and a student, amongst a caring adult and a someone that they're working with, that these conversations or questions can be interactive, and some of the vocabulary that's used can be, that you can support each other. A teenager can support a parent or a teacher in their work, and vice versa, that it's not, this is what the adults are going to force the teenagers to do, but we're hoping maybe it's more grassroots up, that a teenager takes hold of this and then can support their family and their parents through it, because we know there's a need out there for adults as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, as you guys probably know, our sort of new reframe of the vision, purpose, mission of the David Allen Company, and my mission is that we have a world with no problems, only projects. And so for a kid to start to recognize, here's a problem I've got with another kid, with my food, with my whatever, and to say, okay, what would my desired outcome be if I could do that? Mm-hmm. How early can we train kids and any of us to start to think that way? That's a huge global thing to do. And as Mike, you and I know, you know, for years I've talked about, if we could just get this to kids, that's really the answer, because kids go, okay, how am I supposed to think? Because they haven't built in their habitual grooves about thinking about things, opening an email and closing it back up without thinking about it. They haven't built those grooves yet, as most adults have. So, you know, that's the hope of the world.
So that for me, that kind of triggers, you know, the ability when you've got a child and they're kind of fresh and energetic, and discovering the magic of discovering what's on your mind is what comes to mind for me. And one of the things I did with my kids for a couple of years is at the beginning of the summer, I would give them a blank stack of empty index cards. And then I would leave them in a room for about 15 minutes alone. I would leave them with a question. What would you like to do or have true by the end of the summer? Write down one idea per card on your mark, get set, go. And then I'd come back in 15 minutes and go, oh my God, you had all this stuff in your mind and now it's out here. These pieces of paper were blank and now they're filled up with all these ideas. This is awesome. And then we proceeded to put it up on a big old corkboard that we had in our house at the time with a line. And the objective was simply to get something over the line. So the idea, though, was to connect back to, I have an idea, I can externalize it, I can go back and revisit it and ask, is it done, yes or no? If no, what's the next action I need to take to try to move it over the line? I shared that recently with a work colleague. She went back and did it with her kids. And she came back and showed me this beautiful poster that they made. It had a pouch of cards on one side and then, you know, the repository for the duns on the other. So that was a moment of celebration for me. The celebrating that I was just a vehicle to help them discover what's in them. I was just a vehicle to drive them around and be the next action so they can go out on that play date with Anna or something like that. So that for me was just beautiful. And I hope that many families and individuals, teachers can find their own kind of beauty in discovering what's on the mind of their young person in their life, because it's rich and so full. I'm just really excited to hear those stories as they come in.
Mike, when you were talking about that, it made me think of even just scaling back just to the way that we are empowering just through next action thinking. And my three-year-old, you know, comes up and has a conflict with one of her siblings and says, you know, they're not giving me this toy or whatever it is. And simply in my own questioning to be able to say, well, what would you like to have happen? And I'm trying to get at, what would you like to be true? And that can go one of two ways. That can go in the, I'd like them to leave me alone and I want to play by myself. Or I'd like to play together. And whatever her answer is to that, I just, well, what's next? What could you try? What's your next action? And so even as young as three, just sending that message of, I'm not the one who's holding the keys to your future. You're the one in control of making a decision and trying something. And I'm here to coach. I'm here to shepherd. Yeah. But that empowering piece of, what would you like to have be true? And what's your next action? I think that can start as young as being able to speak. And then in those teen years, I mean, that messaging and that empowerment is just, I'm excited. I hope that comes through. And then when young people read that, they feel a sense of ownership and power and control that they haven't experienced before.
Wow. Yeah. Elegant. Okay, guys, final comments. What would you like people to know that might be listening to this or hearing this?
You know, from my perspective, I'm just curious, you know, curious to see what resonates with you in the book as a reader, as a caring adult. If you're a teen or a young person listening to this, what's got your attention about the book? On the GTD for Teens site, we'll have a newsletter that you can sign up for. We'll be sharing stories. So I think for the next period of time, we're just going to be gathering short stories, sharing them back out with the community in the spirit of discovering, sharing, and kind of multiplying the energy and getting this ball rolling. But right now, right here as the book launches, I'm just really curious.
Yeah, I think to young people out there, I think, you know, we're three old guys here talking about what it's like to be a teenager. We don't know. I mean, today is so different than it was when we were growing up. But just to hear that this isn't the GTD methodology, and specifically the GTD for Teens book, isn't the way to gain control and perspective. It isn't the way to live out your life, but it is, there are ideas in here to experiment with and try out and see what resonates with you. And we feel like there's gold to be mined here. And if there are pieces that don't resonate, drop them, let them go. And if there are pieces that are, experiment and play and iterate and make them your own. But just hoping that what's presented is empowering and helpful, and just grateful for the opportunity to share in the conversation.
Thanks. And a great stuff from both you guys. Thank you so much. And next steps, as you said, the GTD for Teens site is up and links to newsletter and communication. As that may grow and develop, it a lot of it depends on who's interested and who shows up and who's willing to play. So don't be shy. Stay engaged and involved with all of us. We're all happy to do that. So thanks for listening, guys. There'll be information on the site about where you can go, things you can do, other kinds of stuff. So make sure you stay in touch. Thanks for listening.
If you're interested in finding out more about learning and applying Getting Things Done for Teens, head over to gtdforteens.com and gettingthingsdone.com for more information about GTD in general. Well, that's going to do it for this episode, but until next time, I'm Andrew J. Mason, asking you, what's your next action?